Dear students, welcome and thank you for tuning in to another Statics and Dynamics video with me, Dr. Loay Al-Zube. We are presenting here in this video the last video actually of lecture 16, which is the lecture about the method of sections for or determining the forces in members of a truss. The previous two videos of this lecture, we talked about the applications, why we want the method of sections, and then we talked about the steps to follow to use the method of section in finding the forces in members of a truss. In this video, we're going to solve an example together to apply all the steps that we talked about and presented in the previous video. So this is our example. We are giving this truss structure. It's a simple truss, but it's having a lot of components. This is what we're given, loads as shown on the truss. So you can see that we have two support reactions at A and G, and I have three external forces, 20 kilonewton, 3 kilonewton, and 40 kilonewtons, and all of them are going down in the y-axis. We would like to find the forces in members KG, KD, and CD. So that is, this is KD, KG, and CD. So it's this one here, this one, and that one. And I mentioned before the method of section is important when we would like to find the forces on the middle of a long or big truss. So if you want to do the joints method, you need to go one joint at a time, and this time consuming, this is going to be a long process and you're probably going to make, you know, calculation mistakes. So that's where this is an example of where the method of sections is very important. First, we need to take a cut through members KG, KD, and CD here, pink line, so that it can expose the internal forces, and that gives us the forces that we would like to find. And then we'd like to work on the left piece of the cut section. So this one, this piece here, this part here. So why is that what we would like to work with? Well, I'm going to show you because it's related to finding the support reaction at A. So these two steps are related, and those we should always start with finding the reactive forces. And this is an advice for all students before analyzing the section method. If you have a structure like this, always try to or present your reactive forces. So at point A, this is a pin. So I will assume there is an AX and assume an AY, right? This is my second, and this is a like a roller. It's going to have only one component, GY. So the first step, doing a free body diagram of the entire structure, forgetting about all the trusses in the middle. So I would say that, okay, I have this structure here. I have one reactive force, two reactive forces, three reactive forces, and you add the three, right, external forces, and you need to analyze the system, the entire system first, to find these reactive forces, AX, AY, and GY, right? Three unknowns, you can construct the equations of equilibrium, you can say summation of forces on the X equal to zero, summation of forces on the Y equal to zero, or summation of the moment around a point equal to zero, and these three equations can give you the three unknowns that we are looking for. So that's always start with this step. This is step one. Assume they have a big structure and find the reactive forces first, then you do the section, you start analyzing. And after finding the reactive forces, you do the sectioning, and then you start applying the equations of equilibrium to find the forces in KG, KD, and CD. Again, three unknowns. You can also construct summation of forces of the x-axis equal to zero, summation of forces y-axis equal to zero, summation of moments around a point equal to zero. And then you can solve for the unknown forces. Let's go through the analysis step by step and show you exactly what do I mean by all what I've mentioned so far. First, we need to find the reactive forces. As I mentioned before, we assume AX, AY, and A and GY. The first thing to do is actually to analyze the summation forces in the x-axis. Remember, I'm assuming that I have this structure. I don't care what is in it, I just have these three components. So if I said summation of forces in the x-axis equal to zero, what forces do I have in the x-axis? I have only AX, so AX equal to zero. That's the first thing. And this will answer the question that we said, why do we want to analyze this section, this part, selecting the part with the lowest number of unknowns is that what we're looking for. So once AX is gone, I have only AY and GY, so they're both two unknown forces, so I can pick either the left side or the right side, but I'm going with the left side now. Now, to find, I still need to find AY, right? So I can say that let's do the moment around either point, the A or the G. Let's select the G point. Again, I'm still analyzing the entire structure, right? Yeah, I'm not doing anything, I'm not doing any sectioning yet. So I'm trying to find a Y here, and don't forget your external forces. So this is what I'm going to analyze. So I'm assuming that I have just this black box. I don't care what's inside. I want to analyze for AY. I will want to find the moment around the point G. So if I assume that counterclockwise is positive, if I'm analyzing the moment around G, remember, the moment is always force multiplied by the distance. So how many forces do I have? If I want to find the moment around G, it means any force that passes through that point is not going to create a moment. So GY is gone, and that's why I selected G. So I have only four forces left. Let's start with AY. AY is going to rotate clockwise, so that's negative AY, and the distance from G to AY is 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. So that's my 12. Now, let's do the 20. 20 is going to rotate counterclockwise, which means that's going to be positive, and the distance between the 20 here and G is going to be 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. So that's the second term. Third term, same thing. 30 multiplied by 8 and 40 multiplied by 6, and this is your equation for the moment. And when you move AY to the other side, add all of these, divide them by 12, and you get your AY to be 56.7 kilonewtons. So this side here now, my section, I don't have any unknown external forces, right? So I can do the sectioning and start analyzing the internal forces, which are the forces inside the members. If you draw a free body diagram of the section itself, so I will use AY to be 56.7. That's what we called, what we did before, what we calculated before. I'm doing the sectioning here, so I'm not going to use any of this structure. I'm going to assume all my forces coming out of the joints here, as we agreed before, intention. So I have FKG, that's unknown, FKD unknown, and FCD unknown, right? So now I have a system of three unknowns here, FKG, FKD, and FCD, that we would like to solve for, right? Okay, same procedure we're going to do. Forget everything we did before. Now I'm going to construct a new set of equations of equilibrium. So I'm going to say summation of forces on the x-axis equal to zero, summation of forces on the y-axis equal to zero, summation of moments around a point equal to zero. And I always like to start with the moment first, and I would like to select a point where it has the largest number of unknowns, so that I can eliminate them. And what if we wanted to do, if we assume also the moment, the point at which you would like to find the moment, it's not necessary to be on the structure or the section that you've selected. I can say, well, I'm going to do this point here, right? This point is D. And in D, we have two forces coming in D, which is FKD and FCD. So if I did the moment around D, I eliminated two unknowns, right? And the only thing left to unknown value of the force is FKG. So I can find FKJ. Let me show you what does that mean. So if I assume to find the moment around D, again, I've selected D, because unknown forces passing through D, so that eliminates them when we calculate the moment and makes my calculation simpler. So if I did the moment around D here, and again, the point that you could select to find the moment around should not be on the section. It can be outside that section, as long as you know the distances between the values. So what do we have? I have 56.7, and if assuming counterclockwise is positive, this 56.7 is going to rotate clockwise, right? So that's negative. And the distance between A and D is 2, 4, 6. So that's 6. Also, I have the 20. The 20 is going to rotate counterclockwise, so that's positive. And the distance between this line of force, which is at P, to D is 2 and 4, so that's 4, right? I'm doing a D, right? So I have 2 and 4. The third one is actually the 30. 30 is going also counterclockwise, and that's positive, multiplied by a distance 2, and that's my force. Now, the only thing left is FKG. These two forces passing through the D, so there's no moment. The distance is 0. FKG is going clockwise, so that's negative FKG, and the distance between the line of action of the force and the point D is 3 here. So that's 3, and that's your equation. How many unknowns do I have? One unknown. Move the values to the other side, and you can find FKG equals minus 66.7. So it's negative, which means that it's compression, right? It's pushing on the, it's not coming out of the joint, it's pushing on the joint. So that's compression. And that's what's happening also on the member as well. So we were able to find the first internal force of the member inside the member KG. Okay, so what's next? After doing this, now I'm down to two unknowns, so I can do the force, summation force on the x-axis, summation force on the y-axis, and we can find our unknowns. So to do so, summation forces on the y-axis, what do I have on the y-axis? I have positive 56.7, that's positive. I have minus 20, minus 30. And then also I have FKD here, need to be projected into X and Y component. So I will do project FKD here to be FKD multiplied by 2 divided by the square root of, so if you flipped the triangle, this is going to be square root of 13, because you have 3 multiplied, square is 9, and 4 squared is 4, 3, and 9 plus 4 is 13. And you have the y component going down, FKD multiplied by 3 over a square root of 13. It's going down, and that's what is this here. So I have only one unknown, I can find FKD. What's left? FCD, you can do the x-axis, right? And on the x-axis you have FKG, which is minus 66.7, and you have FKD multiplied by 2 divided by the square root of 13 multiplied by the force FKD that we found, that's it. And then also you have positive FCD, and you can find your FCD and you get the values that you're looking for. So we were able to find all values now using the analysis. Please keep in mind the section method is, or the method of sections, is a little bit, complicated, and it needs a lot of, you need to be very careful when you do it, because you need to use the equations of equilibrium multiple times, and so you need to construct the different set of equations of equilibrium every time you use them. So when we did the analysis for the entire structure to find the support reaction forces or the reactive forces, we constructed a set of equations of equilibrium. And then after we did the section, we constructed another set of equations of equilibrium. So keep that in mind when you're analyzing trusses using the method of sections. I hope that this example was clear. If you have questions, please let me know.